Is everybody in? Is everybody in? The show is about to begin.
Welcome to the podcast, Conscience That Made Us. Interviews and stories, tales from the bus. We love taking you back to when it all went down. The greatest live shows and that cheering crowd sound. It's Concerts, Concerts That Made Us, ConcertsThatMadeUs.com.
Tristan, you're very welcome to Concerts That Made Us.
Hiya, how you doing?
Good, good. How's yourself?
Not too bad. I've survived this far anyway, so.
We're just getting started, so I don't know how to take that.
First
of all, you guys have a pretty big gig coming up on the 16th of December supporting War of Attrition. Give us all the details about it.
So that is in Pharmacia, which is in Limerick. If people don't know and want to go, it's in Limerick. I've never been to Pharmacia. I think it's like Limerick Fibbers, kind of, but maybe a step up. I'm not 100% sure. But yeah, we're supporting the War of Attrition. It's their gig. As well as that, it's Slaughtern. I think I'm saying that right. Slaughtern from up the north. They're a newish band. And open the show, it's Goblin and Sharktooth. I think they're two separate things, but I think for this, they're working together. Oh. It's more of an electronic sort of a thing for that. But yeah, they're opening. And then Slaughter and then Us, and then War of Attrition. And I'm looking forward to that. It's our second time ever in Limerick. So hopefully it goes better than the last time, because we played the Siege, and that was great. Stayed overnight, drove home, and my car just shit the bed on the M7. It was great.
Oh, my God. Well, at least you made the gig. That's the main thing.
That's it. I was actually, because I've had car trouble like the entire week leading up to it. And I dropped it with someone on Friday. I wasn't around on Friday. And then Saturday, I was like, you have the car back. I was like, cool, great, brilliant. And we were like 10 minutes out from Dolan's in the car. And I see like the smoke start to appear. And I was like, no, not now. Please, please, please. Like, we have to be there. Like, by one, come on. And I was like, oh, no, it's just the drummer's vaping in the back. I was like, all right, that's grand.
Oh, man. And where's the best place for people to get tickets at this stage?
They're on both tickets.ie and Eventbrite. And if you go to ALM Promotions or Cell Games, our own profiles, like in our link trees, there will be links to both of those. To the best of my knowledge, I'm not sure, because I think the mechanics of both sites might be a bit different, but to the best of my knowledge, it's €8 in advance. Or if it's more of a last minute thing for you, it's €10 on the door. So it's like, it's a small saving, but like, it's, you know, like that €2 could go towards something else. It could go towards Cell Game stickers. Right?
It's not bad though for a good gig like that with a good amount of bands, you know, it's a good price.
Definitely, especially if you do like avail of the fact that it's only €8, that's a lot of gig for not a lot of money.
Yeah, exactly. And it's put together by ALM Promotions. They seem to be doing great things for the rock community in Ireland. They're putting on lots of rock gigs with great bands.
And they seem to be kind of a little bit everywhere as well. Not like everywhere, but like normally you see like a promoters, it'll be Dublin and maybe somewhere else in Dublin. And then they might venture towards Wicklow a bit or something, or up towards Dyle, but that's kind of it. Or like some places might do Cork, and that's kind of it. But she seems to be like, she's kind of Cork, Limerick, and then a few in Dublin. And she seems to be working a lot with, I don't know if you've seen Nutshell Grunge.
Yeah,
that kind of collective. They seem to kind of be sort of working together there. We're not part of that. We're not necessarily a grunge band, but we know all the lads in it, and it is good. Just we're not, we wouldn't fit the remit of that. It'd be very strange. Like, they'd all be coming in doing their grungy things, and then we'd show up with like with a laptop with all the beeps and boops, and it wouldn't really. It might, but it's not the same thing. But yeah, they're definitely like doing it. I've done an ALM gig in a different band, and like, it's very good. It's great stuff.
I was actually wondering that the last couple of weeks. I was like, are they part of the Nutshell? Because new metal doesn't really blend with grunge too well. I was wondering, were you part of it?
don't know. I mean, we're friends with all the lads, but like we're not quite within the parameters of it. But we have like I've gigged with some of the other bands in it. Like Ritual Effect are like a very good friend. Like I've been in bands with the lads from Ritual Effect, and we played gigs together in Dublin and all sorts of things like that. So like we're not opposed to it, just like we're not in it.
I get you. And Cell Games released Jailbreak on the 1st of December. Tell us a bit about the track.
So that one is, it's an interesting one for us because normally with our music, it kind of starts with me because we started out as more of a recording sort of a thing anyway. And I had these demos and then Maximilian, our frontman, like initially it was just us. And I was like, hey, do you want to make these demos into songs? And like, it's kind of a new metal thing. And I'd like present him with these and we do that. And then since getting the full lineup, like we'd demo that out and bring that into the band. And they'd kind of, I'd be like, do like the drums are like this, but do them like they're good, please. Like the bass is like this, but do it like a bass player did it. So we'd always be kind of working on stuff that I brought in and then Maximilian would work on and we'd have that. But this was one that had been kicking around for years. It was like a Maximilian Foy solo thing. Maybe even 10 years, he might have had it kind of knocking around in some form or other. And it was just like, it's just a hip hop thing. It was just a rap song. It was a rap song. But he was like, we don't have anything in the set that fills the hole that this song kind of filled. So it might be worth examining this and maybe seeing if it could be like a Cell Game song. So like I listened to it on his SoundCloud and I was like trying to figure out like how does it translate? And turns out it translates very well. But some of it's mad because it was never intended to be played by people the way he did it. Like it was just like programmed stuff. So I had to kind of go like, right, well, the bass line's not really playable. What's close and can do that. Or like the percussion's like a real drummer has to do something over that. And even when I brought like the demo, the demo was like Jailbreak brackets, Cell Games version. And but even like I brought it into like a practice and the drummer kept me. He was like, so the drums and that, like, what do you actually want me to do? And I was like, just do whatever. Like, I was literally just like, look, I just have it this way. It gets small, it gets big, the chorus is bigger, the bridge is smaller. Just do something with that. And it's very, very, Tanchi is his name. I know it sounds like a descriptor, but Tanchi's name. It's very Tanchi, kind of drums in that song. Like, it's just stuff like you just try things in practice. And then, like, you hit on that one. It's like, that's the one. That's the song now. Do that. Or like there's a big double kick part in the middle that I didn't think to program because I was like, I'll just copy and paste the halves, it's fine. So yeah, it's kind of, it went from being just a Maximilian solo thing to like this weird new metal demo of it that I had to like what it is now. Like even the guitars and the verses, that would just be like kicking around in practice. I'm going like, I have to play something, but I don't know what. So just keep, I'll do something. But yeah, it came out on the 1st and it's done the best of anthem we've done so far, which is great. Oh, I kind of hoped it would because, yeah, when we were playing Metal to the Masses in February, people kind of latched onto that one a little bit. There's even, I don't know if you've seen it, Cosmo Palace, Angel, he does like a lot of music video stuff and he films all the heat of that. And he had like a video from one of the heats and it was just Cell Games, but it's just every time they say Jailbreak. And so it's just a couple of things like Jailbreak, 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 Jailbreak. I was like, we do say Jailbreak a lot. You're not wrong.
It's a great song, though, and that's a really interesting story to it. But it's kind of really fun and grabs your attention straight away. And I've been diving into your music over the last couple of weeks now, and the first thing I noticed about you guys is, I was like, no way these guys are from Ireland. They're actually too good. They have to be like veterans of the scene in the States, you know. How did you guys find your style and your sound?
I suppose that it does help a bit that like, if we're not young lads. And we've all done lots of other little bits before we got together. So initially, like it was just me and Maximilian at the start. And the way I met him was He was playing in a band called The Actual Mafia, which is, it's a very silly band name, but they were very good. I think I knew the drummer from that band, and I think I tangentially knew the bass player kind of, and I was like, oh yeah, I go to your launch in Thomas House. And after the set, I had to go, I just went up to him and I was like, man, I got this idea that I want to play Blood Sugar Sex Magic all the way through with a band, and I want you to be Anthony Kiedis. And he was like, yeah, okay, brilliant. Yeah, cool. I'll just add you on Facebook. And then like, I never did that. But then a few years later, a few years ago at this point as well, it'll be 2018, I think, is when I came up with the idea. Like, it was Chester Bennington had just like passed in July 2017. And even at that point, I was like, someone needs to play Hybrid Theory all the way through, and it should be me and someone else. But all my friends were like, there's no, like, you can't, there's no time to do that. What are you talking about? I was like, okay, but like, for his anniversary, like, we should do that. And like, the proceeds should go to where it would be like, it would be a cool thing to do. And Maximilian just showed up in my DMs. He was like, hey, I want to be your Mike Shinoda. I was like, yeah, absolutely. Do that. And we did that gig anyway. It was Hybrid Theory all the way through. And raised like, I think a grand or thereabouts for Aware. And afterwards, I was like, you know what? It is very fun playing new metal. And I thought like, because it was like, there was kind of still a bit of, like, if you said new metal, people would be like, oh, massive jeans and rapping and turntables, that's not good. But I was like, you know what? This is actually really good. And everyone here is like really into it. And even the bass player in that band, like, he hadn't listened to Linkin Park ever in his life. Because he's like, he was 23 or something at the time. So like, it just passed him by completely. But he was like, you know, some of these songs are really good. It's like, they are really good. That's why we're so upset. just after that, I was kind of like, in tandem with still doing that and making it an annual gig, I was like, man, I have all these demos and they're all like, just when we go to do riffs, they kind of come out like this anyway. I think we should like try and do this. And like, towards the end of 2019, we were kind of kicking like demos back and forth. I had like maybe two or three demos that I was like, I think these could be the ones that might be songs. I don't know. Like, they're all very copy and paste. Nothing has a bridge because like, they're just like, it's a verse and a chorus, and I just copy and pasted it because the song has to have two verses and two choruses. And we were kind of trying people out and stuff. And we had a drummer and we didn't have a drummer, and we auditioned bass players and we were looking at other people. And then it got to 2020 and we're like, right, well, there's no gigs. Can't really do anything. So it was like, will we actually just do these songs and I'll like record them a bit better, and you send me over your vocals and we'll do that. And we got the first song out that way, The Configuration. It came out at the start of 2021. And even on that song a little bit, the way I'd written it initially, it was kind of this thing I had in my head where when we were jamming stuff out, I was still very like, well, like, we have to be able to do it live. So like, it's just, you know, guitar, bass, drums, vocals. And like, I'd maybe do overdubs, but really I want to have like the focal points be playable live. And then with that one, I was like, ah, well, like, there's no gigs. So, you know, it's kind of whatever. So there's like one keyboard part in that song, or like there's big layered vocals that we maybe can't do live. And then it was a few months later and I was like, you know what? There's still not gigs. And I've been kind of looking into like, how do you do tracks live? Everyone does it anyway. And I was like, it's time for me to embrace the fact that, look, there's going to be tracks. It's fine. So like the next single was just like, well, this is unplayable without tracks. And I was like, we're leaning into like the electronic part of it. And that's like, Relics was that one. And that's still in the set. So we kind of went that way. And then we got to, I think, the end of 2021. We were kind of like, right, well, the end of 21, was it the end of 21 or 22? When it was like, oh, gigs are back. Either way, gigs are back. And I was like, oh, we're not ready.
Yeah.
Oh, no, we blew it. I was even thinking like, oh, we'll do Metal to the Masses. Like, we have like the demos, and sure, like by the time the heats come around, we'll have a band. I think my girlfriend was like, absolutely don't do that because you won't be ready. It didn't, and we wouldn't have been ready. But we got Deb on board then pretty soon. Deb's the bass player. We got her on board pretty soon. And we kind of like tangentially knew her because she played bass in, I don't know if you've heard Witch Kicker.
No, actually.
they were kind of around, like, again, like, sort of before the pandemic. And then I think when the pandemic was over, they kind of did all just kind of done other stuff. So they never really got back together. But the singer from that band is in a band, Chrononaut, right, baby? Oh. And I said to her, I was like, Laura, like, I need a bass player. And she's like, oh, Deb might do it if you get onto her. And I can't remember if I got onto her or she got onto me. And she's like, oh, like, I want to give that a go. I was like, yeah, cool. It's in drop C. Just bring your stuff to Temple Inn at this point and she will see. And we tried a few people before and some people were kind of like, they were good, but they weren't as into it, or like you could tell they weren't really metal bass players. They were kind of doing things where it's like, this is kind of right, but it's not like it's going to be hard to play the songs this way. It's like weird things, like someone was playing on a five string. I don't know, do you play guitar? Is this any useful information?
Yeah, I play guitar. Yeah.
Oh, grand. So, you know, like the five string. So it's down in B, but we're in C. So it's like, so what are you going to just like play everything on the first fret all the time? Like, but that's like, that's really confusing. And I was like, do I have to work it out now? I'll tune down to B. I'm like, okay, you do this. And I said, no. But like, he was a competent bass player. Just, he wasn't a metal guy. He was just like, here are the notes. I'll play the notes. He could like, you could play it, but it wasn't the thing. We'd had people like kind of show up and like be able to play, but not really like know the stuff. But then Deb showed up, and Deb showed up at, like, pretty quickly. We were like, yeah, Deb, like, she's showing up. She's all three demos, like the two singles and one of the demos, she's playing them. Like, there's a few bits that she doesn't know inside out, which is fair enough. Which is like, oh, like, sure, let me know what you think. And I was like, oh no, we have a gig in April. Are you free to stay? And she's like, yeah, probably. She's like, great. And like, she sings a lot as well. She's kind of early on, she's like, oh, if you need stuff for backing vocals, like, I'll do it. And I was like we didn't have time to do arrangements between gigs. So we had like the practices and like, oh yeah, definitely, definitely. And then like, since starting to record, we're like, oh yeah, Deb's doing all of the proper singing backing vocals. I think she's kind of taken on. So she's left me to kind of do all the fry stuff that I'm terrible at, but I'm doing it anyway. Someone has to do it. But she was in first, where we had a gig in April. We kind of decided that rather than wait forever to be ready, we're like, look, we will take the gig and somehow do the gig and do it as like a proof of concept. So like, we had a session drummer step in for that one. And even like the guy who was booking this, my friend Shane, he it's like, oh lads, I think he could do like 40 minutes. And I was like, well, we know 20 minutes of music between us. It's like, oh, I should maybe do half an hour. It's like, you get 25 minutes with talking. That's what you're getting. And I even looked at the set, because I was looking through files for something, and I looked at like the playlist of the set, and I was like, that's mad. There's nothing in that set. But that was a good proof of concept. But the drummer like wasn't in the band. But pretty soon after that, the way we got Tonchi, our drummer, was mad, because I was putting out ads and just like everyone on Facebook being like, hey, Cell Games, we just need a drummer now. Like all the usual stuff, like has to be able to play to a kick, able to play a double kick, just able to contribute, like actually be able to play the stuff. And around the same time, Tonchi had put on his, so like probably even the same forums, he was like, hey, drummer here, looking for a band. Experience playing to a click, normally play metal, I've done a few bits. And I got onto him and he was like, I was going to get onto you. I was like, this is fantastic. And it was a similar sort of thing, like for his tryout, he came to like the practice in, I think we'd upgraded to Troubadour at that point, because like, I don't know if these places mean anything, but like Troubadour is a practice base in Dublin,
right?
And Temple Inn is one in, also in Dublin, it's in Temple Bar. But it's in Temple Bar, so like there's nowhere to park, so I have to get the Lewis in, and it's underground, and sometimes it's a bit damp. And I was like, we just go Troubadour, because like me and Deb drive, so it's fine, don't worry about it. But he came in and did his audition, and he was kind of saying like, he wanted to just like run the first single a few times and like feel it out a bit. And he was like, also like, I know like you have the studio version, and he did like that live version he did with Damien on drums. I think I've got bits from both of those. I want to try some stuff. And like, even in the first run of it, there was like a little gap where I was expecting to just like keep counting so I don't lose the click completely. And he was doing like symbol fields that I never would have thought of. I just looked over at Deb, was like, yeah, I think so, yeah. And like the same thing again, it's like, oh, so what do you think? It's like, yeah, well, we have a gig in, at the end of June, so you're free. And like that's he got in as well. And like a lot of stuff, like he'll take within the demos because like I'll kind of write the drums around the guitars a bit. So it's always like the chorus has to be bigger, the snare has to be on 2 and 4, and the kick kind of has to follow the riff. And it's just stuff, like even stuff like, right, like as a guitar player, you know, like when you program drums, it's like verse is hi hat, chorus is crash, bridge is ride. like that's me doing dynamics, but he kind of has, he like have like just ideas and stuff, and like little kind of like bits will drop out or come in or connect bits in a way I wouldn't have thought of doing. So like a lot of it is just kind of taking like the blueprint of like my demos and then making it like a drummer actually thought of it.
Yeah.
And since recording with Josh, JSR Audio, I don't know if you've ever dealt with him up in Belfast.
No.
He was like, we kind of decided like, right, me doing it on the laptop's not going to hack it forever. Especially because like, I don't have the facilities to record drums. So I was like, we were kind of looking at like, well, where do you go? There's lads in Dublin and they're good. And like, there's kind of the go-to guys for different places. But I was like, well, we're doing heavy stuff, but there's like, you know, there's stuff in the songs. There's like keyboards and bits and pieces and things like that. And we kind of looked at like bands that we knew were around and who they went to. And they all seemed, the ones that kind of were doing similar to what we're doing, like the band Idle Discourse, people say we're kind of the same because they're heavy bands where there is rapping. And it's like,
right.
Yeah, I guess we're kind of the same. Like they're a bit more like I think they're more like something like Architects or something. That's sort of like a bit more genty, but the vocals are rap. Whereas we're like very much a new metal band, and then another band like Neon Empire, where it's like drop G heavy, but there's stuff going on. There's keyboards and there's samples and there's like percussion and stuff. And they all went to him. So I was like, hey, Josh, can we come up there? Can we record with you? He's like, oh yeah, grand, yeah, do that. And we did. And I was like, oh, he gets it. He's like got the sound that we want to get from as well.
Yeah.
And he's great to work with. Like, he's very willing, like, especially with me, he's very willing to like just let me try stuff. Just do stuff. And like a lot of, like mostly what I want to do is I'll play like a part and then be like, oh, I've got an idea, Josh. And it's just me doing like up a third as a joke.
Mm.
And it's like, right, do you want to do a real idea now? I was like, yeah. So like he let me do stuff like that. He's very willing to just do stuff like that or just try different things with electronics.
Yeah.
So like he's a producer more so than just like an engineer. Because like some, you know, sometimes it's just like we just want the song as it is, but recorded. Where he's more like a producer, and he'll have ideas, and like with the vocals, like he'll try like different deliveries or different layers and stuff like that. So like a big part of the recorded sound is him kind of doing stuff what we bring to him.
Yeah. And you know, what's the feedback you guys get? Like, you know, how well are you received? Because I know a lot of people are kind of like, new metal has its time and its place. It was about 20 years ago, doesn't belong in the modern time.
I think when people just hear that it is new metal, like they don't actually hear it, but they hear like, oh, it's a new metal band, they can be a bit kind of like, oh, is it? Yeah, okay. And like you can put people even like they can go in with that and be like, oh, you know, I wouldn't be into the rapping in it. But I think a lot of people, when they actually hear it, they're kind of, they'll remember it from the first time around and kind of be like, you know what, actually, yeah, it is still like, it's fine to like it. Like, you know, the bigger kids aren't going to beat you up. It's fine. You know, like people kind of, I think everyone kind of went away from it and then we're like, you know what, actually, it was good. There was like, there's stuff like, there's so much of it that like, not all of it's good. There's always going to be, you can always find like a bad new metal band, or I can find like the worst elements of it exaggerated in a band and be like, this isn't good. But like Hybrid Theory was huge, and like the first two Slipknot albums were huge. So like, it, like it has its place, but I think when people see us do it live, especially, they get that like, oh, it's fun. That's the big part of it, is that like it's a fun gig, and like the recorded stuff, people have been like, they've been fairly positively into it as well, which is great. And I think just the fact that like on stage, like I think between myself and Max, we couldn't do the dead serious metal frontman thing at all. Like we couldn't bring ourselves to do it. We couldn't be like, ah, Fibbers, our family, friends, let's do this. Like, well, like it's grand. We're just up here like saying riffs and screaming at you. It's fine. It's fun. Don't worry about it.
Yeah. I get you. And when it comes to gigs, then how do you put together your set list? Is it all originals? Do you throw some of maybe Hybrid Theory in there?
Fonty's been lobbying to get some Hybrid Theory into it, just because like I have all the tracks from doing the Linkin Park gig. The Linkin Park gigs as well. The name for that is Phoenix Park, and that was my idea. And I have to just get that in there because it's FENIX. So I was very happy with that. But we used to do, when we had our 20-minute set, we had like, right, we're only going to have a 17-minute set if we don't do a cover. So we did Land of Sunshine by Faith No More.
Oh.
And that was very much a me and Maximilian idea, bringing it to everyone and being like, we're doing this because we only have 20 minutes. And like, we did it a handful of times. And Tanti was like, I don't like playing this song. It's boring. And it's not the way I play. Like, I'd never do this sort of a Tom shuffle sort of a thing. And there's nothing really going on. And like, Deb was like, it was like, it's just, it's annoying to play. And I was like, it's great. This song is amazing. But that got dropped pretty quick. Like, it stayed for maybe 3 gigs. And I think the third one was only because we had 2 gigs back to back and we didn't have time to change the set. But then we were like, well, Maximilian kind of has a sort of philosophy about like putting sets together, especially when they're a bit longer. It's kind of like you have to get people's attention straight away, hold them for a bit, and then like there'll be a lull in the middle. And if you do a cover there, they'll pay a bit more attention. But as we kind of start getting more written and more of our own stuff, and people are kind of starting to react to that, like the need for a cover kind of got pushed out. But we kept a cover of Push It by Static X in the set. And I thought that we always finished it with, whenever we had like a set that we needed like 3 more minutes, I always thought it was at the end. But I was looking back at an old set and it used to be second from the end. And I have no idea why we did that. I think that was like, it was like why they're still paying attention, hit them with this one. I don't know. But yeah, that one, it kind of, we don't do it all the time. But if it's like a 45-minute set, we're like, well, we have these 3 minutes to go at the end. So like there's space for this one. But other than that, like it's all us.
Mm.
And that we used to have an intro track as well. That wasn't us. It was like a cover of like a remix or something. I don't know. Again, I didn't find it. It was sent to me. It's like, this should be your intro. I was like, yeah, cool. It was some piece of Dragon Ball Z music. Because Cell Games. And we had that as an intro track until we realized like a lot of the gigs we're doing, we're just getting a line check. So when it's time to start the set, we're already on stage. And the intro track is a minute long. So we're just kind of standing there like, just pretend this is, I used to actually during it have to go to the mic and be like, pretend we're only coming on now. Pretend you didn't see that. So now we're just like, we have a tiny little intro and straight into it. And it's just like, if you have a half hour set, there's no room to be sticking in covers. And we have like, there's enough kind of types of songs in our set, or there's enough kind of going on that like you can kind of fit all the gaps that you need in a set with like you have like the intro song that's like the most immediate song, the one that was like a single, one that's like not a ballad, there's none of them are ballads yet, but like something a bit slower or a bit more melodic, and then something to, like pick them back up again, that's normally Jailbreak, and then something to kind of like take them back down a bit, and like Here's Your Bones, it's like the single before Jailbreak, that's kind of like near the end. If you have a very short set, that is the end. And then it's like, then the big ending song. That has like a big, there's no fade out. It's a big definite boom, end.
Oh.
So like that's how we structure it now. And it stayed the same for quite a while because we were like, well, like one song was almost written to be an opener, that kind of a thing.
Yeah, Yeah, I get you. And I suppose at this stage, you know, the podcast is called Concerts That Made Us. So I have to ask you, as a concert goer, what concerts do you think have made you?
Very definitely the first one I ever went to, which was Korn on the Take a Look in the Mirror. I want to take a look around. That's the wrong band. Take a Look in the Mirror tour. It was The Point at the time. And Static X were supporting. And oh, I hadn't heard Static X at this point. I think my friends might have, because I didn't have the channel. They probably had Kerrang. So they probably knew a bit more. Like, they'd played, I think the only was in a GTA game, maybe.
Mm.
Or in some game. So, like, they were a bit more at the speed of that. But I was just like, I don't know who this is. I'm just here for Korn. This is great. But then, like, I saw them and I was like, what is this? This is what has happened. And, like, even, like, little things that I still lose my mind for a gig. Like, when the guitarist and bass player swap sides during a song, I still lose my mind for that. I'm like, this is showmanship. Oh my God. But that being like the first gig, I was like, oh yeah, gigs are kind of where it's at, I think. And then there's some other things I've been to where things being kind of funny. Like I used to go to like a lot of Newt Faulkner's gigs whenever he was over. And in between songs, like, it's not serious. It's just like, just a guy having a chat. And, you know, having a nice time with you. And, like, I've definitely taken that to gig. Part of it is, like, not knowing what to say on stage as well. It's kind of going, like, I don't know. They're all here. stuff like that. But those have definitely been big. And I used to kind of... There's probably a period where, like, where every gig I went to, I'd go to and be like, that's what I want to do. Oh, my God, yeah. Like I'd go see Metallica and be like, I want to be in a thrash band. And I want to, like... Yeah, I wanted to be like mics all over the stage, and I want like I think everyone does it where like to see Metallica for the first time, and then when they're in a band, like every time you go into a section, someone goes up to them like and goes, shh, and, like does all that kind of stuff. Like seeing stuff like that was definitely a huge part of like gigs. And like, I think the biggest gig that had an effect on me, I wasn't even at it, was the Chili's in Slane.
Right.
And I wasn't like too, when that was announced, I don't think I was like, it would have been like 12, and I was getting into music kind of at that point. So when it was announced, I was like, I don't even know where Slane is. I'm 12. and I think for Christmas I saw an ad for the DVD that year, and I was like, oh, that looks like it's a good gig. And like, I think I have like the albums and I know the singles, and I watched that and I was like, oh my God, this is gig. Just the fact that like, I didn't realize you didn't have to know what you were going to play. I was like, oh, you could just, if you just know your way around enough, you could just make stuff up and things like that. Or like, I didn't know what backing vocals were really. And I was like, oh, you go over or under the lead or to another part sometimes. And like, that really kind of set me off in that direction. Maybe not very good for learning guitar solos, unfortunately, because I was like, oh, you can just make it up. It's like, sometimes you shouldn't make it up. It's like, ah, yeah, sometimes. Kind of fine, just do that.
Yeah,
so that was like I just guessed that the biggest gig for me I wasn't actually at, but the gigs I've been at, I don't know. I think those are the biggest ones that kind of like shaped where I am, like with gigs. Like, there's gigs that I thought were amazing, but I just thought the gig was very good, and it didn't make me go like, oh, I have to do that. I think that the last one that was like that was just before the pandemic. I discovered the band Twerp. Do you know them? TWRP?
No, actually.
No, they're a Canadian band. It's kind of city pop what they do, but then it's kind of a bit rockier than that. But like, they're very much a gimmick because like they all wear spandex and they have characters and no one knows what their faces look like.
Right.
But they were the backing band for a comedy band called Ninja Sex Party. And we just managed to get tickets to that because I was like, oh, they're from YouTube. They're funny. This would be good. And then Twerp were like they're the backing band, but they have their own set beforehand. And I saw them and I was like, what's going on? What is this? Like the lead singer is not a singer. He uses a talk box and everything. So nice. I've never seen that. And I was like, this is mad. And like, he played a guitar in one song and I was like, I'm sold. That's it. A guitar. What is going on? And just like the bass player being so good at bass and like, it's been like really good at slapping stuff. It made me go like, you know what? I'm going to actually take bass playing seriously now. I think I might actually try to get good at bass. And I've been ages since I'd been to a gig, and it's like, I'm going to actually have a go at that now.
Mm.
So like, that was important. And even like them kind of just messing around on stage and kind of like, it's not 100% serious. I think that was important to be like, yeah, it's fine to like the music still has to be good. And like, you have to be tight and it still has to be good. But like, people are there watching you as well. Like, you know, like if, like especially in metal, I think there is kind of a thing of, yeah, just like, stay in your spots, do the set, and it's very serious. And people are kind of full of the army and like watching what you're doing and being like, yeah, that's good. You got
very
that.
Very judgmental.
Yeah. But we haven't heard a lot of that ourselves though as well. I think we're looking at like, people very immediately go like, oh, it's fun. Or they're doing jokes in between. It's fine. New metal songs. Like, it's fine. There's a song called Jailbreak. That's not the Thin Lizzy one. I think like the main thing I've taken away from a lot of gigs, other than like, oh, you can make it up as you go along. But not all the time. You just have to like know a bit going in. But like just the Chili's being like, oh, you can do improvisation. And then fans like Twerp and like Newton Faulkner gigs kind of being like, yeah, but it's fun. Because like, why would you do it otherwise?
True.
That's kind of the main things I've taken away.
Right. I feel like that you don't go to enjoy a gig, you go to study a gig, you know?
I used to a little bit. Especially when I started, I used to be very like, I had to be like, what are they playing? How are they playing it? I want to know what they're doing. But now I accidentally kind of study gigs a little bit, just because it kind of comes from knowing how to play stuff. You can never really switch it off. I think I always found that, like, even especially when I started like learning how to play, if a song that I knew how to play came on in a place I was, I had to think about what they were doing and be like, have I been doing it right the whole time? But like some gigs, I think if it's something that I know, it's like, I don't play this, like I want to see a ska gig and it's like, I don't play ska, let them away, this is grand, I can take this in. But if it's something where it's like, why are they doing that? I need to know that. I'll study it a bit. But other than that, I do try to just go and enjoy the gig. Even like, there was a gig where it was a weird one in the Sugar Club, where it was a band that don't play seated gigs really, but it was a seated venue that was booked for them. And I was sitting down because like the receipt, and it wasn't sold out. So there was people down the front, and I just felt like I was watching people watch a gig. It was really strange. But then like the following gig I went there, I was like down in it. I was like, oh, I can actually just get into this now because I'm in the gig. But I try not to be studying gigs, but sometimes I do have to kind of like, I'll know what they're doing. I'll be like, oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, I get you. And for any listeners that haven't caught one of your gigs yet, what can they expect? Lay it all out first.
Oh, now there will be goofs and there will be spoofs. It's full on for however long we have, like for half an hour or 40 minutes. There's not a lot of let up. There's maybe a little bit of space for us to catch our breath in between, because like, we're not young lads, but it's heavy, but not like breakneck heavy. But I think just the main thing is like that the gigs are fun, and that there's an energy to them. There's something going on. It's amazing. It's just, they're just fun gigs, and there is like a little bit of silliness. Like I think very early on, I was even just silly things. Like I was like, what do you wear? Like, what am I going to wear for these Cell Games gigs? Like, I'm just going to wear what we all decided. Like, oh, there's no dress code. Just wear what you normally wear.
Right.
And then for one gig, there was a gig where I was pulling double duty. Like I ended up having to like cover bass in the headline band because it was the cover band, so I knew the set anyway.
Mm.
And I was like, oh, I'm going to be roasted. I'm going to have to just like, I'm going to wear like a cut off. I'm just going to wear no sleeves. And I was like, maybe I'm a guy that wears cut off on stage now. And it became that sort of a thing. And like, it's evolved into like Maximilian. I think he wore a blazer to a gig, and it's evolved into like, he just has like a load of weird suits that he wears now. So there's something to look at. We're not just in band t-shirts on stage. But I think you just expect, if you go to the Spotify and listen to that, expect that, but like more.
Right.
More of that.
Right.
More of that. But mainly for me, because like, you don't have to 100% do the part that you had in your head going in. It's a bit like we're still tight, but there is kind of room to mess around. Like even Tanchi before I said at gigs, it's like he described it as like, you know, like we make jokes, you know, like with each other, we're just making jokes. Like, I mean, it doesn't matter because we're inside the song, we're inside the thick, we're inside the like the limits of the song, but like, like we're still, you know, having fun with it.
Yeah.
So hopefully everyone's having fun, and it's not just going like this is gas.
is there a gig experience you've had then that you would say is the best?
In terms of playing or in terms of going to?
That you've played.
Oh, that I've played. Definitely one of the Metal to the Masses heats this year. They're like, that was, I know some people kind of give out a Metal to the Masses, and I know like music's not really a competition. It's not like, you know, it's not a sport. There's not a competitive element to it. But we did really well. So maybe there is. But I think it was the first heat of that we were in, and kind of the semifinals, but especially the first one, because we've been kind of like kicking about as a band, like the full band, the way we were for maybe 6 months at that point. And then the first single with everyone on it had just come out. So people were kind of like, it's a band. It's not just two guys. And we'd had stuff out that were like people that weren't in the band. We did like a video session thing just to be like, look, but we're real people. It's not just a recording project. Like, there's people in it. But this was the first thing that was just the band. And that just came out on the Friday, like the day before we had our first heat. But it was like a lot of people who didn't know who Cell Games were or what we were about, because it was like we'd be kicking around favors a little bit. And then, like, we hadn't done anything over the winter really, so just kind of came back, and it was just like we played very well, which is always like, I'm always very happy with that when we play well, obviously.
Yeah,
but because I remember like the first few gigs we had, I played them and I'd be like, oh, that was pretty good, and then like the second one I was like, oh, that was good, and the third one I was like, between this one and the last one, yeah, that's where it is. But that, like, that one was like, this is like we just played the best we played at that point. And people kind of got it. And like, there's like a little bit of momentum from like that single that I went out was kind of knocking around, and the people hearing it being like, oh, this, yeah, the last one you did, the some of Bones, I was like, yeah, that one. It wasn't like, oh, we've arrived, because like, you know, we haven't arrived, but it was the first kind of like, oh, it's a band. I see now. It's not just guys messing about. It's like, it was like kind of like, from our perspective and like the audience, it's kind of like the best, kind of like, oh, we're playing the best we've been played, and we're being received the best we've been received. So I think that was it. And like the Siege was a similar thing to that. But I was just really tired of the Siege. So the Siege was like, even probably as good, but it was 1 PM, so everyone's a bit tired or like not awake yet fully. Whereas like you're in Dolan's, you're a bit higher. So like, but in February, it was like right up on top of everyone, and everyone's like, oh, I get it now, it's Cell Games. It was like, I think it up at 9 o'clock to do this. Oh, but like, playing wise, good. But definitely, yeah. The Masters was like one.
Right. And to flip it around, is there an experience now? You can use any gig you've ever played, but is there an experience you'd say was the worst, and how did you overcome it?
Let me think. With Cell Games, we've like occasionally been a bit ropey. And been like, you probably should have looked over some of that before. We had a gig once where it was just heck disasters. Like the drummer, he wasn't getting the click in his ear at points. And like, if he doesn't have the click, he doesn't get the cue. So we don't get the cue. So things are a bit wishy-washy. And there was like a new song that had like a weird guide in it. So it was a bit, like, it was very loose. This is also the only we cared about. And I think just the way around that was to be like, right, well, that can't happen again. So we need to just make sure going in that everything's good, and just like make sure our cues are good. But not like on my own, I used to do kind of acoustic-y stuff, and the worst gig I maybe experienced in my life up to that point was I played Knockin' Stockin' on the Sunday, maybe the second last year that there was a Knockin' Stockin', because I knew it stopped a while ago, and I played it on my own. And on the Sunday, they started doing a thing where, because it's sort of residential area, like, look, there's a festival, but from maybe 2 to 3 on a Sunday, I think it was, or 1 to 2, an hour where we stopped. So I was the first thing on a tiny stage that was in the campsite in like a shed after that break. So like nothing's really started up. I'm just one guy in a shed and there was no one. And I was like, don't know if I actually like doing music. This is dreadful. Oh my God. and so like, I don't know, like every kind of one, obviously, because I'm still on the go, but that was dreadful. It was just dreadful. Like, I think I played fine though. No one could say I didn't because there was no one there.
Interesting. And, you know, with Cell Games, then what's the goal? You know, is it just for fun for you guys, or are you serious about trying to make it?
I think we're serious as you can be without like kind of being a bit ridiculous. We're not obviously going to be like, oh well, you know, we're going to set the free arena and do arena tours. It's like, probably not, but we do kind of want to do, like, we want to kind of be, I suppose, medium or extra medium in size. Like, we're not going to be huge, but like, I did kind of start out saying, like, I always kind of shift the goalposts a bit. Like, at the start of the band, it's like, I just want to play fibbers. Dads are always playing fibbers, and I just want to, like, just play my own stuff in fibbers. That'd be great. And then we did like two gigs, and I was like, I want to do more now. I want to do more of those, but I want to move up a bit. And then, like, we printed t-shirts, and I was like, kind of want to set out the t-shirts, so I don't want to do that. And then it was like, then we kind of like, you know, I want to do gigs opening for bigger people. I don't want to just do like throwing together lineups. Like, you want to kind of like open for bigger people and stuff, and like do not necessarily like calling a headliner makes it sound bigger, but like, you know, kind of have enough people that are like willing to come to a gig that it's when they go like, Cell Games is on the poster, come to it, that kind of a thing. And like, just get a play as many places as we can and as much as we can. Like, yeah, we broke Limerick now, I guess, because we're doing like Limerick on Saturday. Yeah. But like, even like just like to play like all the obvious places, like we played Fred's and we played Fibbers, we're going to play Pharmacia. I'd like to get up the north. I'd like to get to Galway. I'd like to get to the UK, even though I think I do get seasick. So I don't know. We'll figure that one out. We could fly. I just put the gear on the ferry. I don't know. We put the gear in Deb's van on the ferry. Be grand. Don't get me on that. I won't feel great. But yeah, just kind of just always grow a bit. Like, hopefully not just kind of just being, not be like, you know, like bi-monthly Fibbers gigs and that's it. They kind of be like, Cell Games are on the bill, check it out, that kind of a thing.
Yeah, I get you. You don't want to kind of plateau, you know, keep pushing forward.
Yeah, like I don't want people to go like, Cell Games, that's still on the go. Like, yeah, we are. Yeah. They say it like that.
And, you know, when it comes to the band, how do you handle disagreements and differences, if there is any?
We don't have, or haven't anyway, any massive disagreements. Like, any kind of disagreement is always just kind of like trying something in a song and being like, it's not great, is it? And like, normally if, like, because it's like, it's an even number of us, so if three people go like, nah, it's not great, then it's like, oh, fair enough. But generally we kind of, everyone's very open to everything. There's not a whole lot of disagreement in the band. Everyone's kind of like if we're kind of like, oh, if you do this gig, if someone's like, nah, it's not worthwhile doing that, it's like, oh, I won't do that. So, or like, there's never been any huge kind of like disagreements or falling out. Yeah. Anyway,
I hope I didn't jinx, you know.
I don't know. I hope not. everyone's easy going enough for like, again, it's the same. Like, I've said like a few times, but like we're not young lads. We've all been in bands, so we kind of know that like, you know, we take it seriously, but it's like, you know, like after this gig, I'm going to get up tomorrow and I have to do normal stuff, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you know, still have to, you know, if someone's like, give it out, it's like, I can't believe, why would you do, like, how is it this way? And then like, the next day I'm like, right, well, I got the email to tax my car, so I may go and do that now. like we take it, you know, we take it seriously, but we're not taking it like stupid serious. So I think that stops us kind of putting heads too much about it, because like, it's, you know, it is only rock and roll or whatever.
And before we
dive in, won't be any,
go on,
I'm just saying, hopefully there won't be any massive rows anyway,
fingers crossed. Don't blame me now if there is, after asking that question. Before we move on to the last couple of questions then, plans for 2024, any gigs, any new music you can tell us about?
2024, the first thing we have straight out of the gate, we're playing in the Next Big Thing Festival, which is it's in the Workman's Club in Dublin, across like the two floors of the same building, but I don't think you can access them from each other. But there's like the Workman's Club is the main room, the Workman's Cellar is the downstairs. I think they connect in the building somehow, but the entrances are on like opposite sides of the block. I don't know how it works. But the timetable hasn't been like put together properly yet. But that, I think it's the 23rd to the 27th of January. I think those are, I know it's like the last week, Tuesday to Saturday. I think those are the dates. And we're on one of the stages on one of the days. And that, if you check out the Next Big Thing or XO Promotions, EXOH Promotions, there's links there to like early bird tickets. And again, they never told me the pricing structure, but there's some sort of structure where it's like you can go to like one day or all the days or one room or both rooms or something. But like I think you just go to all of it and we'll be there. After that, we have Our Heat in Metal to the Masses, which hopefully goes as well as the last one in that we get through, or at least it's good. That's on the 10th of February. And if you go, you have to vote for us because it's my birthday that week. So what are you going to do? Not vote for me on my birthday. We should have new music out then soon, hopefully. We haven't nailed down any dates. And if I start throwing out dates, it won't happen. You know what I mean? I don't want to kind of go like, oh, yeah, 23rd, yeah. And then something happens, it's like, oh, it's not ready. But there's stuff recorded. We've been working on the video for something like in the background for a while. That like hopefully will come to fruition. We were in the studio 2 weeks ago, I think. The day after Jailbreak came out, we were in the studio working on the next thing. It just lined up that was like when you were able to do something. So we're kind of kicking around like, do we do infinite singles, or do we hang on a bit and make that an EP, or do we hang on a bit more and make that an album? But there will definitely be something out. At least one thing, definitely more, within the span of the year. But the main thing is like gig at the end of January in Workman's, Metal to the Masses. And then if you just follow us on sellgames.mp3 on Instagram, you will hear about whenever the music is coming out. But soon is the plan. Unless the files go away. unless the file goes away, it won't come out. But like it's February-ish is the plan. And then we'll see. But we're kind of, we've managed to end up slightly ahead of where you want to be in terms of like the stuff we have ready. So we didn't think we'd have enough stuff ready. So now we're like, oh, what do we do with it? Where does it go? That's better than going like, no, we have to get to here now because it's not ready yet.
Yeah, exactly. Well, there's plenty to look forward to next year anyway. And we'll dive into the last few. So these are a couple of random weird music questions. First one, if you could see any performer from history in concert for one night only, who would it be?
Oh. Can it be someone that's still going, but at a different time?
Yeah.
Because I would like to see Red Hot Chili Peppers closer to the time of the Slain gig. Because I know it's the same lineup back together now, but it's not quite the same. It's not the exact one that I remember being so into. Or if I could see Static X again, because like I know they're around now, but it's not really Static X. it's most of Static X. So if I could see them for real, now that I actually know who they are, I'd be big into that.
Yeah. Were you at the Chili Peppers gig last year?
I was, and I was big into it, but it was like, It was like a festival crowd, but it wasn't a festival because you paid €90 to go see Red Hot Chili Peppers. And like, maybe it was dependent on the area, but where we were, it was a lot of people who kind of were just going because there was gigs on during the summer. And like the new, not even songs, they knew The End of Snow, they loved that bit, and they loved Other Side, but not necessarily like all of it. But like the bit took my kiss and I was like, I was loving it, and just people didn't know what it was. And I was like, why are you here? I don't understand. Or like the encore where they didn't play Under the Bridge. Loads of people were upset and I was like, I'm sick of Under the Bridge. Were you at it?
Yeah, it was.
Yeah. Like the encore of Sir Psycho Sexy into Their Red Hot. I was like, that's like something I would say as a joke.
Mm.
I was like, oh, wouldn't it be funny if they did Sir Psycho Sexy into Their Red Hot? And then they did it. And I was like, this is great. I don't even care that no one can get a taxi. I went to bed. This is amazing.
Yeah. I thought the exact same though. I was standing there looking around and I was like, you know what? The half this crowd looks like they've never even heard of the Chili Peppers.
Yeah. I think the thing with the Chili Peppers as well is like, I get the impression they don't understand why people like them and come to their gig.
Mm.
Like, I think they think everyone likes it the same way that I like it. Whereas like, I want to see them do like album tracks and I want to see them like just try stuff or like, just fuck about and do things. Like they did a lot of, they're kind of getting into like, yo, at the end of a song, the song will be over, but they'd still just be playing something. And I was like, this is good. This is like I'm seeing a band perform and there's something dynamic happening. Whereas people are going like, oh, where's the one about Danny California? Is that next to her?
Yeah.
So, like, they don't know that people just want the songs off the radio sometimes.
Yeah.
I was happy. So if they keep doing that, I don't mind.
I seen him back in, I think it was 2004, 2005 in the Phoenix Park. And they were unbelievable. I suppose that was probably a year or two after Slain, was it? Slain was,
that was
2003.
I think so. Was that with Pixies? They opened for Pixies or Pixies opened for them or something?
Pixies opened for them, yeah. It was unbelievable.
Yeah, I think I was like, I think I might have been like 14, so I think I'd been like, you can't go to that, you're going to Metallica this year already. I was like, okay, fine.
right. Looking back now, it's a tough choice, but I'd probably go for Metallica myself.
Yeah, I think like my friends wanted to go to that, so I was like, oh, this is what I'm going to go to. And I think, would that be the year they had, I don't know, Slipknot were playing with them, or was that the following year? That was the following year. I think this might have been like Saint Anger-ish.
Yeah.
When they were still touring Saint Anger, but they kind of realized it's like, that's not what people want. So like they play Frantic, and I was like, okay, that's what we're here to promote anyway.
Mm. Yeah. And the next one, so this is where the weird part comes in. If you had to be locked inside a room with any musician from history for 24 hours, who would you pick?
My God. 24 hours. Let me think now. It's probably a lot that I wouldn't want to be. They're a bit sinister. Who would I want to be in a room with? I was going to say Rick Rubin, but he's not a musician, and he's explicitly not a musician. But he's just really fun to listen to. And he would just tell me over and over again how he's not a musician. But I could listen to him like, hey, he can do a lot of saying nothing after saying a lot of stuff. It's just really pleasant to listen to. It'd be like falling asleep to a podcast.
Yeah, true. It's a good one. First time anyone's ever picked him, actually. And the final one, what song would appear on the soundtrack to your life?
Ooh, good one. I should have thought of an answer for this because it's a very good question. I don't know. I've never thought about this. This is actually going to stump me. I'm trying to think in terms of songs that. Actually, you know what? It's a stupid answer, but I think it would be the soundtrack of my life. I think it would be kind of somewhat appropriate, kind of given how long I've been doing music, and that's kind of the thing I've been doing for longer than I haven't. I think when I reached a certain point where I started playing when I was 11. So then when I was 23, I was like, I've been playing longer than I haven't now. That's it. I can never be playing less than the time I wasn't playing beforehand. So I think the opening theme from King of the Hill, because it's the first thing I ever learned how to play on guitar. And my dad, who's not even really a guitar player, but he kind of like sat down with the two chords he knew and he worked it out for me. And that's like the first thing I learned how to play. And I didn't even learn it in the right key. But I think that would be sort of appropriate because the first tattoo I got was last year. And I just got like the standard chord symbol for G major on my leg.
Right.
And then immediately, like, ankle socks went out of fashion. So I was like, no one's ever going to see this. I think it would be appropriate. It'd be very good, kind of like, G's the first chord I learned. That's the first thing I learned using G, even though the song's actually in E. But my dad didn't know E, only knew G and C. So that's the way we learned it.
Right. Has to be that one. So listen, Tristan, thanks a million now. It's been a blast chatting with you over the last hour.
Oh, thank you. I come to Pharmacia. Everyone come to Pharmacia on Saturday.
Welcome to the podcast, Conscience That Made Us. Interviews and stories, tales from the bus. We love taking you back to when it all went down. The greatest live shows and the cheering crowd sound. It's Concerts, Concerts That Made Us, ConcertsThatMadeUs.com.